My presentation today is largely based on a paper and a review which we recently published at the International Institute for Environment and Development in London about agroecology. It's meaning to different actors and its benefits and the way it can be promoted and upscaled more widely. More and more often we hear about agroecology and agroecological farming, and indeed the public profile of agroecology has been recently raised by not only peasants' organization and big sovereignty movements, but more and more often also by international organizations like FAO and other UN development organization, by governments such as France that declared that wants to make the nation a champion in agroecological farming, and even by corporations like McDonald's in France that states that sources its products from agroecological farming. So it's clear that while it's good that agroecology has been mentioned more and more often and brought to the attention of the wide public, on the other hand, the attention by so many different actors means that the meaning to each of these actors can be very different. So before I go ahead with our view about what are the benefits of agroecology and what are the policies and the practices to upscale and to adopt it more widely, I would like to briefly introduce what's the meaning of agroecology for us, for me, which can be also a point for discussion and dialogue later on. But just to have clear what we are talking about. So to start with, I choose a definition which is quite a common, commonly agreed definition of agroecology by Miguel Altieri, which says that agroecology is the application of ecological concepts and principles to the design and management of sustainable agroecosystems. So, from this definition, it's clear that agroecological farming is not defined by the practices themselves, but to the extent to which these practices apply or respect a number of principles. So in order to define whether a practice or an approach to farming can be defined agroecology, we should first look at what are the principles, the ecological principles behind these practices. I'm sorry about this slide, this is a box which is in the publication and it's quite tight. I should have reduced the text, but we might want to focus on three or four of these principles that can be then detailed, articulated more. But the first principle of agroecology regards to relates to planning. And that's the main difference for me between agroecology and conventional farming. So the approach to planning is not just about the field, the farm, but about the agroecosystem, which is seen as a whole, a unicum. So the focus is on the interactions among the different components of the agroecosystem, the farm and its surroundings, and not just on individual crops and breeds, which is mainly what the modern agricultural science focuses on. So this, related to this, this system should be not maximized, but should be harmonized within its potential, its productive potential. So we are not looking at a maximization of yields, maximization of profits, but we are looking at an equilibrium. We are looking at self-regulation of all the components of these systems, so the farms and the landscapes that surrounds the farms. Another important principle in, agroecological farming is the recycling and the efficient use of resources. So again, we are not looking at the maximum exploitation of the resources, we are not looking at the short period, but we are looking at recycling and enhancing the natural cycles of resources. We can say, we can talk about biomass, we can talk about soil health, we can talk about water, and all the other inputs and natural resources make the basis of farming. As Jesper said, the farmer is not a producer, he's a manager of all these resources. And what we need to do in agroecology is not to make the most of these resources on a very short time, but make what is possible to make these resources last as long as possible within their natural cycles. This implies also that the energy sources that are used in farming should be as renewable as possible. There should be a reduced use of agrochemical, because of course not harming the environment is the first step in order to make it last as long as possible. And we should use resources that can be sourced as much as possible within the farm or within the local context. So local seeds, local breeds, composting, and so on. Another important principle of agroecological farming is to enhance the biological interactions between the different components of the agroecosystem. So, for instance, in pest management, we talk about pest management, not about pest control, because using the right interaction, the right biological interactions between pests, plants, and crops, we can easily control the pests and make them less and less harmful over the time, rather than control them and, on the other hand, maybe increase their resistance to control methods such as pesticides or herbicides. Related to this, there is the need to diversify as much as possible the species and the genetic resources of the agroecosystem. In other words, to enhance as much as possible the agrobiodiversity of the ecosystems. So, from this list of principles, we see that it may be very difficult to define with 100% of certainty whether an approach is agroecological or not. Let's take, for instance, conservation farming, which some of you may be familiar with. Conservation farming is a farming approach that basically relies on three practices, that is, use minimum or no tillage of the soil, use cover crops and mulching to enhance the biomass of the soil, and promote intercropping and crop rotation. But the ways these three practices are adopted may be very different in large-scale monocropping agriculture in South America, where farmers use conservation farming to produce soy or maize for the commodity market, where they use these three principles, but along with these principles they also use heavy machineries, they use herbicides. And so we can see that yes, there are some aspects of agroecological farming, but on the other hand, some of the principles are not completely respected. On the other hand, conservation farming adopted by small-scale farmers somewhere else may actually respect all the principles and be considered 100% an agroecological approach. The same we could say with organic farming. There are organic farms, very large organic farms, that produce and supply for supermarkets, for instance, that look at standardized production. So, of course, they apply some of the principles in terms of using biological organic products, sourcing inputs, organically and so on, but on the other hand, they might be less agroecological in the sense that they don't look at food sovereignty, they don't look at the improvement of the biomass in the soil, they don't look at the recycling of the waste, and so on. So this is just to say that in this presentation I talk about the benefits of agroecology, meaning agroecological farming approach that apply as much as possible these principles. And in this sense, we can say that the reach in the, using Peter Ross's words, an optimization of the system, in the sense that they use to a maximum extent as possible the application of these ecological principles. So, what are the benefits of agroecology? First of all, of course, there are environmental benefits because agroecological systems are more sustainable from an environmental point of view. This is because of the same. They don't use harmful inputs to the environment, so they avoid pollution and preserve the agrobiodiversity. Because they are founded on complexity and diversity of the species, they are more resistant to pests and diseases in the long term. Because of course, by diversifying the production, by diversifying the range of species on the farm and in the landscape, the crops and the yields are less prone to failure over the time. So if one crop fails 1 year, we will have a range of other crops and other trees that they don't. Thirdly, they are more resilient to climate variability, and that's again because of the complexity of the system, because of the diversity of the system. Agroecological approaches are more resistant because are more easily adaptable to what is happening. They change more quickly to external pressures. On the other hand, conventional farming is based on standardized solutions. These solutions are rarely developed on the farm, are brought from external actors, and so the capacity to adapt to an external change of conventional farming is much slower, and in some cases it's just not possible. In addition, agroecological farming can also actually mitigate climate change. And this is because, for instance, conservation, no-tillage and minimum tillage allows for a greater carbon sequestration in the soil, or simply because they use less fossil fuel-based inputs like pesticides, fertilizers, and more generally they tend to use more renewable energy sources. So the first benefits of agroecological approaches are definitely those related to the environment and to climate change. But agroecological practices can be also better compared to conventional farming in terms of productivity. What I'm saying is not that crop yields in agroecological farms are necessarily higher than crop yields in conventional farming. Because we are not looking just at individual crops and individual breeds, but we are looking at the productivity overall on the farm, we definitely have a higher level of production, a higher level of output. And this is because they rely on a diversified pool of crops and on livestock. This in turn means also that the yields of crops and livestock are more stable over time because, as I said before, are less prone to the risk of failure. But most of all, the reason why we should regard agroecological farming as more productive than conventional farming is because, apart from commodities, food, fibers, and meat, what they give us is what we call ecosystem services. In other words, environmental services which are not commodities, but are equally and probably more important to our society, not just for farmers, because as Jesper said, that will allow our food system to last longer and to sustain themselves. So for ecosystem services, we mean higher biodiversity. We mean that imply, for instance, this is a big problem in the UK, the sustaining cross-pollination, for instance. We mean the conservation of the landscape. Again, you might have heard of the floods that we had in Somerset recently, and that was largely due to unsustainable farming practices, which and reduced funds from the government to actually manage and conserve the landscape and the boundaries along the rivers. So, even if it's very difficult to quantify on a monetary basis these services, this should be regarded as actually outputs of farming, which in this case, as probably Hoffman will speak about later, is regarded as multifunctional farming. That means multifunctional is not looking just at commodities, but at other function. So the function of agriculture for agroecological farmers should not just be to feed the world or to feed the industry, but also to provide a number of other services which are that should be valued as much as the commodity outputs. And thirdly, agroecological farming, and in this instance, I'm thinking especially in low-income and middle-income countries, can actually offer higher food security and a stronger food sovereignty to local communities. And this is because by diversifying the pool of crops and livestock produced on the farms, not just the quantity of food and available is larger, but is also healthier and more diversified. So food security is not just meant as supply of food, but also quality and appropriateness of this food. And agroecological practices actually sustain also food sovereignty, because the farmer and the households are at the center of the production process. So technologies, innovations, processes are not driven by the outside, but it's the farmer that, yes, can adopt some of the technology from the outside, but it's his role to adapt and develop these technologies on the farms in order to adapt them to the local conditions. So agroecological approaches are highly context specific. And that's one of the reasons why they are not very appealing to the industry and to the market. So, but on the other hand, can place the farmer at the center of the production within the farm, at the center of the provision of services for the society, and also, why not, at the center of the markets, if the power of a highly concentrated sector is reduced, maybe some more space can be given to farmers and agribusiness that want to develop appropriate technology for organic, conservation farmers, permaculture farmers, and so on. And that's why within this chapter I also include as a benefit the fact that farmers' dependency on markets, and especially on external inputs, farmers' dependency on the volatility of prices, both of inputs and commodities, with agroecology is reduced, because the food systems are relocalized and less dependent on what happens on the rest, in the rest of the market. The benefits that I listed here have been demonstrated by quite a wide range of literature, ranging from scientific articles to reports from international organizations. And what is striking about this, these benefits is that they are especially relevant in marginal environments. So not only agroecological approaches can be more productive and more sustainable than conventional farming in a, let's say, in a standard situation, but if we look at very marginal environments, places that are more subject to land degradation, to climate variability, in this context, not only agroecology is an alternative, it's actually one of possibly the only options that farmers have to cope with extreme climatic events. For instance, if we think of droughts, having available a wider range of crops make farmers less sensible to risk of failure. And also has been demonstrated in many places, especially in Central America, that farmers that were applying agroecological principles were had less damages from tornadoes and other extreme climatic events, because the higher vegetation, the stronger structure of the soils of their fields resisted better to heavy rains and wind and so on. And also the economic and the social benefits, as I mentioned before, are very important, especially for poorer farmers. Farmers that do not have access to economic resources, but that hopefully have access to land and to labor, which is not everywhere, but still abundant in many countries, especially in sub-Saharan Africa. For these farmers, having this kind of practices available for production is very important, because it's not just a mean to increase their food security, it's also a mean to raise and improve their livelihoods. For instance, from my experience in Lesotho, where very small scale farmers, I'm talking about less than an hectare maybe for a household, were practicing conservation farming. That was the only way they could raise their yields. So the soils were very degraded. There weren't resources to buy much of fertilizers and other inputs. So the system that they received, but not from external organization, by local organization, was really critical for them to found an appropriate method to increase their food production. And the yields were really surprising. Of course, I'm not saying that these practices came out of the blue, because actually many of the agroecology practices that I've listed before are embedded in local traditional farming. But in that case, the help of local trainers, motivated farmers that involve the community, the strengthening of the social capital within the community actually helped these practices to be applied and upscaled. Because we will see in a minute the time that farmers need to uptake and adapt these practices can be one of the obstacles and one of the field of action that we should look at. So, as I say, despite of these benefits, public research, extension, agricultural policies do not look at agroecology, or they do not do it extensively. So I've tried here to list what, in my view, are the major obstacles to the adoption of agroecology and what are the latest fields of intervention. I think this is quite a complex and broad field of discussion. So I just try to focus on what for me are the more direct causes and the more important ones. So, first, whether even if it's true that agroecological practice do not need a large amount of physical inputs, let's say external inputs like fertilizers or pesticides and so on, they still require a high amount of what I call soft inputs. That means labor, but also and especially that means knowledge, management skills, and experience, experiential learning. The need for these soft inputs is not necessarily an obstacle for the farmers, especially if they are adequately supported by communities and international, but especially local institutions. But still, there is a need to support these farmers with appropriate research and especially with appropriate knowledge diffusion methods. So I think the first field in policy and action that should be changed in order to adopt agroecological practices more widely is in research and extension. There's no space here to talk about, you know, the way that agricultural research is locked in certain paradigms, but definitely agroecological curricula should be included in research programs. That means that more funds should be available for these. That means that also curricula, the training, agricultural training should be changed. Not just in order to make agroecology more present in agronomic sciences, but also in the sense to value more what traditional farming, traditional knowledge from farmers can teach scientists. So along with this, it's not just a matter of dedicating more funds, it's also a matter of pursuing a real new approach to disseminate this knowledge. So when I talk about participatory innovation systems, I don't like to say participatory innovation system that allows farmers to participate, that still implies some sort of top-down approach. What we should probably pursue is participatory innovation systems that rely on farmers rather than allow farmers participation. So farmers and farmers' knowledge should be the basis for innovative process of production, of generation of knowledge and dissemination of knowledge. But still, of course, we need some support from researchers and scientists to analyze what these practices can offer, how can be improved, how can be adapted to local context, and also because farmers need some incentives to bring along their work and their innovation processes. Along the same line, of course, extension systems should be changed accordingly. Among the soft inputs I mentioned, there is also labor. It may not be always the case, but many agroecological approaches require more labor than conventional farming. This is not necessarily a problem, especially at small scale level, because at small scale level, labor is actually more productive than at the larger scale. But there are situations where the rural landscapes are changing. So there are situations where labor cannot be available, for instance, because large spread of HIV, for instance, or because main components of the households are leaving or migrating to finding jobs elsewhere. But we should also take into account that many low-income countries, even rural countries, are going through rather fast agrarian transitions where the young population is increasing, and many of these youth don't want to stay in farming or would prefer farming to be more attractive to them. And off-farm alternative employment opportunities are not just in the urban context, but also increasingly in the rural context, because rural economies are also diversifying. So another action that policymakers and organizations promoting agroecology should take into account is to provide incentives for people to stay in farming and to farm sustainably. And I know that the provision of incentives and subsidies is rather a politically sensitive topic, but from an economic point of view, in this case, I think they are fully justified by the fact that these farmers are not just providing food, but they are providing a series of other public goods that are not marketed, are beneficial for the whole society, and so in a sense the society, the public funds, should pay for. So they should be supported, and especially in this transition time where labor, the acquisition of management skills may be an obstacle to them, and they should be supported because in the longer term they will yield profits, they will yield benefits, not just for themselves but for the whole society. So the provision of incentives for the early adopters for me is one of the policy options, and of course governments both in the north and in the south should start thinking seriously about payments for existing services to be embedded in agriculture, rural development and environmental climate change policies. Another important action for policy is securing access and rights to the to land and natural resources. Why? Because many agroecological practices imply investment, long-term investment in land. So if farmers are not sure about their rights to those resources, they might not be willing to invest in these resources. So this is one serious obstacle to the adoption of agroecology, sustainable practices, and should be part of the related field of intervention. But as I say, these are for me the main points, but these are, I mean, just part of a wider picture. Even if we solve these three, four points which I mentioned, this might not be enough. So what we should look at, we should look at a wider policy scope on a longer term perspective, and more broadly to pursue agroecology within the vision of more sustainable farming and food systems. So that means that we should protect local knowledge, we should reduce the powerful interest of too concentrated agriculture sector, and many other things which I don't think have time to mention. If I have just a few minutes, which I'm not sure if... 5 minutes. I just want to conclude because we are a research and a policy advocacy institute. So what are, in brief, what is the where research and advocacy should stand in this picture? So how we can help achieving this objective, how we can help agroecology to be more widely adopted through our work. First of all, there is the need to consolidate evidence that support agroecology through multidimensional analysis. That means that we should find a better, more effective way to communicate what the benefits are, not just in terms of yields, but also in terms of all that, those non-commodity outputs that I mentioned in terms of public goods, biodiversity, ecosystem services, and so on. Some studies are available, but I think many of these studies are a bit out of date. That doesn't imply that the conclusion of these studies are not valid. Still implies that the benefits of agroecology are there, but what has changed in 10, 15 years so far is the context. So when we look at agroecology and benefits, especially if we want to analyze what are farmers' motivations, what are farmers' drivers of choice, we should look also at what are the alternatives for the farmers. So that means that we should probably study a little bit more what are the financial returns, what are the returns to labor for farmers, and compare them with the alternatives they have. And this in order to assess and quantify better those incentives that public policies should give them in order to go for agroecology rather than for the alternatives. And as I say, this is especially urgent now because the agrarian transition are taking place very fast, and because the interest of investors, both national and international investors in land and other natural resources is increasing very fast. So policies should be faster than investors to grab that potential. That's again about farmers' drivers of choice. And finally, but not less important, what research and policy advocacy should do mostly is to promote a radical shift in what we regard as productive, what we mean by efficient. And this is a mental shift which is not just for farmers, producers, it's for the society as a whole, because we are voters but we are also consumers. So if a change in what we mean by productive, so if we stop looking at efficient, something like maximized production, but if we start looking at optimal solution, if we start looking at long-standing equilibrium, if we start looking at sustainability rather than at quantity, profits, and short-term benefits, then we can actually help this shift to happen, not just sustaining policies when we go to vote, but through our daily actions and behaviors. So that's, for me, the most important. I'm sure I jumped on many issues, but that could be taken up later, maybe.